Computer architecture, floating point, part three of this lectures about floating point. Let's continue where we left off. So we had here our numbers that we were representing with three digits. That is called a fraction, and then an exponent of 10, because this was, we talked about decimal numbers here. So we had three digits like in front, and then 10 times 10 to the power something with had two digits. So we used five digital decimal digits for representing a number. And this limits, of course, the number of numbers that are possible. As you know, this will be 10 to the power 5. So this is 100,000 numbers in total, so this is limited. This fits in a finite state machine, and it also has plus and minus, so this is still times 2 times 2. So instead of 100,000 we have 400,000 different numbers. And here we talked about the ranges, and if you put four digits for the fraction and one digit to the exponent, then you actually have a higher precision calculations, but lower range of where your calculations, you will easily get into overflow and underflow, of course. Now, let's go here to our computer. Let's go to binary representation, binary numbers, because of course, you know, the computers don't work with decimal, they work with binary. But let me just keep this here for a moment, because I want to later remind you of this. So now we have what is called the IEEE standard 754. IEEE is a Bureau of Standards, and they invented the standard 754. And this is about how to do floating point. Now, how to represent floating points in a computer. So the first thing is that now we are talking in binary. So a number is a fraction f times 2 to the power exponent. And this exponent, I don't talk about yet how many digits there are. But let's see how it is done in a computer. As we know, a computer has 32 bits in total. Here we had 5 decimal digits to represent a number. Here now we have 32 bits to represent a binary number. I will talk about two types that is described in this IEEE 754. That is single and double. There also exist extended, but I will not talk about this. Actually, I will only briefly talk about the double and focus on single, because the rest is then self-evident. So the idea is that the first bit of the 32-bit register, or whatever pattern you can call it, the first bit is actually then the sign. So we have here again, we're going back to sign magnitude representations. Then we have the exponent, which is this value here. Well, not exactly. This represents, this stores the information of the exponent, but it's not directly this value e that is here. And the same accounts for the fraction. The fraction has 23 bits. This exponent had 8 bits. 23 bits, 32 in total. And this fraction has got something to do. It stores the information about this fraction here. So we have three formats. Single, 32-bit. Double, 64-bit, which then has 1 bit for the sign, 11 bits for the exponent, and 52 for the fraction, and extended 80 bits, which I will not discuss anymore. One sign is for the most significant bit. Now I want to keep this here on the side here. I prepared it so that you can see this. One bit for the sign, 0 is positive, 1 is negative. The exponent is 8 bits, or 11 bits for double. The exponent is written in the format excess 127, and that is something new, it is for singles. Because normally we had 1's complement, 2's complement, and the other one was sine magnitude. No, we don't use like this anymore. It is a positive-negative number. This exponent can be positive-negative. And it's excess 127. That means that the binary number that is here, unsigned int, we have to subtract from this unsigned int that is exp, we have to subtract 127 to get the exponent here in this representation that we have here. So that is, we call excess 127, and it's excess 1023 for doubles, but never mind. To give an example, Imagine that this bit pattern stored in X is 0000001001. So that means that it's equal in unsigned int is equal to 9. So we have to subtract 127 from that, and the exponent then is minus 118. The bit pattern 111 is reserved for special use. We will see in a moment. The fraction is also something strange with it, because it contains 23 bits or 52 bits for single and double. But as we have seen before, also here, we had normalized the fraction here in front, so that there will always be a non-zero digit in front. Or actually, we could say that before the floating point, there will be no zero, and the first non-zero number should start will be this one. So let's do the same for here. We normalize it that in such a way that there is always one point something as the first digit and then the floating point. But if it is one point something, if it's always one point something, then we don't need to write it, because it's redundant information. So we don't write it, and then it's called implied. The one point is implied. So what is written here, I have to put this, so what is written here in the fraction is the after the one point something. So the real fraction is one point, the bit pattern, what is written in frac. Let me see where I'm at. This bit pattern frac plus the leading one. We call this significant. So the significant is one point and then the fraction pattern that is stored in these 23 bits here or 52 bits here. So in total we have n equals 1 point frac times 2 to the power x minus 127. Let me give you an example. Let's assume that we have the hexadecimal 32-bit value, hexadecimal 3F00000. Or in binary, that is 00111111, etc. 000. Okay, so we have to cut it up instead of hexadecimal code, hexadecimal values here, characters. We have to cut it up in 1, 8, and 23. So that is 1, 8, 23. And we see that the sign 0 means it's a positive number. The exp, this number is actually, this is equal to 126. So 126 minus 127 is minus 1, so the exponent is minus 1, and the fraction is 0, but don't forget that the significant then is 1.000000, so that is 1. So we have 1 times 2 to the power minus 1, and that is 0.5 in base 10. So to finish this up, I hope you understand this this reasoning. You have to play a little bit with this, pen and paper, try it, and actually you can then later, I will put in the next lecture, I will show you how to work with it in the assembly, so that you can check actually your answers. But to finish this, I want to say that the above numbers, as we put here, they were normalized. They're always one point and then some fraction. But we also have things that are denormalized, and that happens. Special convention is simply a convention. There's nothing proven that it has to be like this. This is just the IEEE convention that if the exponent is 0000 and the fraction is non-zero, then it's denormalized. And in that case, if it is denormalized, then we don't use excess 127, but we use excess 126. Meaning that it is now this, which is 0, minus 126. So the exponent is minus 126. And this fraction now is 0 point something, this fraction. So now we can get the smallest number we can represent is 2 to the power minus 126, 0.00000000001. And that is then, the smallest number is then denormalized number is 2 times 2 to the power minus 149 in total, and that is about 1.4 times 10 to the power minus 45 in decimal. The other thing, the convention is 0 means that we really have 0 in the exponent, and fraction is also 0, just by convention, this is the only zero. Okay, you have plus and minus zero, but we now also have something special that is infinity. In infinity, you have the exponent all, the exp combination is all ones, and the fraction is all zeros. This is plus and minus infinity. And we also have NaN, which is called not a number, if the exponent, the exp combination here is all ones, and the fraction here, frac, is non-zero. So this is just a special convention for IEEE. You have, in principle, you have normalized numbers. Everything is normalized numbers. And then if you look at the normalized number, the smallest normalized number you have, the exp combination is 0000001, meaning it's 2 times 1 minus 127, remember, excess 127, and the fraction is all zeros, which means that the significant is 1.0, so the total is 1.0 times 2 to the power minus 126, and this is about, in a decimal, is 1.175 10 to the power minus 38. You can actually check this on your computer or in C, what is the smallest number that you can get. I also put your calculations for the largest denormalized number and the largest normalized number. And actually, I would like you to do this calculation yourself. You see here the answer, but see if you can come up with this answer, if this is correct or not. 1.7175 10 to the power minus 38 for the largest denormalized number, and for the largest normalized number, it is 3.403 10 to the power 38. So in the next lecture, I will show you how to implement this, how to use floating point in actually in assembly.